like to welcome everyone this evening to our event with Pavlos Tsimas, commemorating and celebrating the exploits of our namesake, Michael Dukakis, for his role as a public figure in the United States, and particularly for the fact that he was the first Greek-American to run for the presidency of the United States 30 years ago, almost to the date, in 1988. We'll talk a little bit more about who we are, the Dukakis Center, a little bit later in the program. I would like first to read something that Michael Dukakis penned back in 1998 when he was first approached by the Board of Trustees of Anatolia College to lend his good name to what was then an endowed chair in public policy. "I am honored and touched that the Board of Trustees of Anatolia College would view my work as impetus for establishing a chair in public policy and service. As much as this touched me personally, I must remind everyone not to lose sight of the most important issue, that with the establishment of this chair, Anatolia is adding a new field of study to its curriculum, which will educate members of the next generation of world leaders. If you want to know what our mission is at the Dukakis Center, there it is, from the horse's mouth, from Michael Dukakis himself." Now, I'd like to introduce our speaker in just a moment, but let me start first by thanking a certain number of individuals who are here. You'll notice that there are several cameras. We're being filmed in one way or another by live media and by Ad Art. Ad Art is producing a documentary on the 20th anniversary of the Dukakis Center, and they're preparing an archive of our events going back as far as we have film of such events. So I want to thank you gentlemen for being here. We are doing a simultaneous translation, as we've done in the past, and it's Michael and Cleo Weber who are in the booth, sealed off from the rest of the world. We've had great times with the Webers in the past translating our events, and I'm very happy to welcome Michael, particularly back to his alma mater, the American College of Thessaloniki. I owe a debt of gratitude to my colleagues in the college relations and marketing departments, here in the person of Olga Tandila. I think Narusida was here, but I think she's ducked out. The vast amount of work that goes on behind the staging event is done by them in their offices. So Olga, thank you very much. We're happy to be hosted by the staff at the Bissell Library, represented in the person of Evi Tramansa, the director of Anatolia Libraries, and we're grateful to you for your hospitality. You'll see there are a certain number of young people holding microphones, bringing glasses of water, doing other such things. They're interns at the Dukakis Center. We have something rather remarkable this semester. We've added to the number of interns who are taking a degree from ACT, the University Division of Anatolia, a senior from the high school, Anatolia College, who will speak to us in a little while. So George, I'm really pleased to count you among the people who are involved in the project today and to have you speak a little bit later this evening. Last but not least, Dukakis Center would not be anything without the contribution of my wife, Fotini Estratiado, who gives meaning to the work we do every day. So, Fotini, thank you very much also. I'll call our speaker up now. It's a gentleman whom I've been chasing, hunting, hounding for the better part of a year. He spoke at the Reworks Agora event last September of 2017, at which we co-hosted the keynote session. And I recalled at the time that he interviewed Michael Dukakis in September of 1999 when we inaugurated what was then the Dukakis chair. And I approached him with the idea that maybe we'd collaborate together on an event here in Thessaloniki. It transpires that he has an interesting history with Anatolia. Perhaps he'll share it, perhaps not. But here, a little over a year later, I'm very, very pleased to welcome and to introduce Pavlos Tsimas, journalist from Athens.
Καλησπέρα. Και ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ για την πρόσκληση. Χαίρομαι πάρα πολύ που είμαι εδώ. Είναι καιρός που θα ήθελα που κουβεντιάζαμε τον David και ήθελα πολύ να είμαι εδώ να γνωρίσω καταρχήν το ACT, το οποίο το βλέπω για πρώτη φορά. Έχω δει το Ανατόλια πριν από αρκετά χρόνια. Το έχω επισκεφθεί μερικές φορές. Όπως είπε ο David, παρά λίγο να ήμουν αποφυτός του, αλλά τα πράγματα είχαν αλλιώς. that's a bit of my life story. I was telling David my father died when I was 3 years old, so I was raised by my mother and my grandfather. My grandfather at the moment was judge. He was serving here in Thessaloniki, and he loved the city, and he proposed that I would come with him in Thessaloniki instead of staying with my mother in Athens. And when I was at school age, and be a student of Anatolia. But my mother resisted. She had just lost her husband. She didn't want to lose the son. And so I stayed in Athens, and I missed Anatolia. That's my chance to see what I lost.
Welcome. Welcome,
man. Welcome. OK, thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Good. We thought that we would have a bilingual conversation about Michael Dukakis, what you thought of Michael Dukakis. And I'll explain a little bit to the audience why I've chosen this format. We operate as a bridge between two countries and two cultures, the United States and Greece. We'd like for the dialogue between these two cultures to be seamless. The kind of conversation I have with my daughter, whom I'm raising to be bilingual. I answer a question in English, and she answers me in Greek. So we're going to shift back and forth in languages, and hopefully this won't introduce an element of discomfort for you. Your first memory of Michael Dukakis?
Well, I first met him in 1999. At the time he was running for president, I was a journalist, and I was following with passion his campaign. Of course, because he was a green American, but also because he was the most progressive, open-minded, liberal person that has run for office, for the office, for the White House, maybe since George McGovern, I don't know. And so for me it was really interesting. And I had the chance to meet him in 1999. I interviewed him. It was a very formal interview. I tried to find it and bring it and give you a video of it. But unfortunately, it's in the Mega Channel's library archive, which is for the time being sealed and inaccessible, so I couldn't get a copy. I interviewed him a couple of years later when he was visiting Mytilene on radio. And then finally,
he has family originally from Mytilene.
That's why he was there. It was the first time he went to the island. So I had a chance to do an interview with him on radio about his visit in Mytilene. And then in 2008, I had this experience. I was planning to do a documentary for the beginning of the race between Obama and McCain. So I went to the United States for this project. I was lucky enough, I was there just 2 days after Lehman Brothers collapsed. So I was obliged to do two stories, the campaign and the economic, the financial crisis, the beginning of what might have been the new 30s, or might still be. So the idea was that we will do the story and the interviews and everything, but the main thing would be during the night of the first debate between Obama and McCain, me with a cameraman, I would be in Harlem in the Apollo Theater watching the debate with 2,000 people from the neighborhood who were gathered there to watch, and it was a night of passion for them. They cried. They were very touched by it. And a colleague of mine, with another cameraman, would follow the debate in a typical redneck, gun-loving town in Virginia. And so that we would show the reactions of two Americans to the same event. The next day, I traveled to Boston to meet Mike Dukakis. That would be, and talk about the campaign and his own experience, and of course, what a television debate can do to a political campaign. So we had an appointment that was the time I really met Dukakis. We had an appointment at 10 o'clock at the Northeastern University at his office. I arrived there. There was someone at the gate. He told me which floor and what, which room. I went there. There he was. He showed us around. We chose together where we should set up the cameras. And he said, "Would you like some coffee?" I said, "Yes, if it's possible." So he went himself to the cafeteria. He brought up the coffees, and I was amazed. And then we discussed.
Sorry to interrupt. My favorite story. I visited him in Boston a little bit later. He invites me to his house for breakfast. He cooked me bacon, pancakes and bacon. He cooked it himself with the apron and everything.
That's it. So, and of course, we talked a lot about American politics. I said, "I'll blame myself for the rest of my life for losing that elections. Haven't I lost the 1988 elections? Bush the father would never be president, so Bush the son would never be around. We would have never been in Iraq. There might never have been an economic crisis in the United States. So it's all my fault," he said. "It's all my fault. Blame it on me." And I asked him about the famous debate and the famous question about Kitty and how he would react. And 20 years later, if that question was raised again and you were campaigning again, how would you answer it? He said, "I would frame it a little bit differently, but I would give the same answer because that's why you let me lead. Mm-hmm. And I'm true to my beliefs." So what struck me with Dukakis, later on I read recently, last year, an interview for Boston Globe with Dukakis. And the journalist that spent the day with him noticed that when they met at 8 o'clock in the morning and they walked to Northeastern together, and Michael Dukakis had a plastic bag, mm-hmm. and he was collecting garbage. Picking up the litter from the street. And this is the impression I got of him. And I think it is important because we are used to have politicians that are masters or students in the mechanics of power and the art of communication. But what we really need, and we have deep in our heart what we need, would be a politician with a sense of civic duty. Now, I'm not sure how would you translate civic duty in Greek.
That's part of what we tried to do at the Dukakis Center. Miros, post fanate, or Michael Dukakis, εδώ στην Ελλάδα, και post fanate, και τώρα.
Αυτό θα ήθελα να το ρωτήσω εγώ στους φοιτητές, δηλαδή στα παιδιά που είναι που παίρνουν μέρος σε αυτό το πρόγραμμα. Τι είναι για αυτούς ο Μάικ Δουκάκης, εκτός από ένα όνομα στο πρόγραμμά τους. Την εποχή που ήταν υποψήφιος πρόεδρος, φυσικά ήταν big thing για την Ελλάδα. Αλλά κυρίως επειδή ήταν Ελληνοαμερικανός. Δεν είμαι σίγουρος ότι στα αλήθεια και παραμένει ένας πολύ συμπαθής άνθρωπος, νομίζω, στην Ελλάδα. Δηλαδή, για τον μέσο Έλληνα, ο Δουκάκης είναι ένα πολύ, πολύ οικείο και πολύ αναγνωρίσιμο, αλλά και συμπαθές πρόσωπο, αγαπητό πρόσωπο. Αλλά τι στα αλήθεια είναι ο Μάικ Δουκάκης, δεν νομίζω ότι πολλοί Έλληνες το γνωρίζουν. Και για μένα, εκτός από αυτό, ότι είναι δηλαδή ο τύπος του πολιτικού που έχει πέρα από την τεχνική της εξουσίας και το κόλπο της επικοινωνίας ή την ικανότητα να διαλέγεις τους ανθρώπους που είναι καλή μηχανική της εξουσίας και καλή τεχνική της επικοινωνίας για να κάνεις πολιτική, να έχεις βαθιά μέσα σου και μια αίσθηση ευθύνης, μια αίσθηση ότι αυτό που κάνεις είναι γιατί πιστεύεις ότι κάθε άνθρωπος έχει μια υποχρέωση συμβολής στο δημόσιο χώρο, στη δημόσια υπόθεση, στην κοινωνία. Αυτό είναι το ένα χαρακτηριστικό που εγώ βρίσκω στο Μάικλ Δουκάκη, για να γυρίσω στα ελληνικά. Βρίσκω άλλα δύο. Ο Δουκάκης είναι και μου μίλησε γι' αυτό, θεωρεί ότι ο ρόλος του πολιτικού είναι να είναι consensus builder. Να λύνει τα προβλήματα χτίζοντας συνενέσεις. Αυτό δεν είναι πια ο τύπος του πολιτικού που είναι της μόδας. Ο Τραμπ δεν είναι consensus builder, είναι το αντίθετο, ανατινάζει γέφυρες. Αλλά ο τύπος του πολιτικού που ανατινάζει γέφυρες φαίνεται ότι είναι της μόδας αυτή την εποχή. Την Ιταλία την κυβερνάει ένας τέτοιος άνθρωπος, την Ουγγαρία την κυβερνάει ένας τέτοιος άνθρωπος, την Πολωνία την κυβερνάει ένας τέτοιος άνθρωπος και γενικά στον κόσμο φαίνεται ότι οι consensus builders δεν είναι αυτό που κερδίζει ψήφους αυτή τη στιγμή. Και αυτό είναι ένα πρόβλημα, το οποίο νομίζω δεν μπορείς να το αντιμετωπίσεις παρά με διάφορους τρόπους, αλλά με έναν τρόπο με το να επικαλείσαι το επιτυχημένο παράδειγμα ότι αυτός ο δρόμος όταν χρησιμοποιήθηκε δούλεψε. Το δεύτερο χαρακτηριστικό του Δουκάκη, γιατί νομίζω ότι ακόμη είναι πιστός στην ίδια ιδέα, είναι η κεντρική ιδέα που έκτισε αυτό που ονομάστηκε The Massachusetts Miracle στα 12 χρόνια που ήταν κυβερνήτης της Μασαχουσέτης. Ο λόγος που έγινε υποψήφιος πρόεδρος, έτσι δεν είναι, είναι ότι είχε πίσω του ως κυβερνήτης της Μασαχουσέτης τρεις θητείες. Εκείνη την εποχή θεωρείται ο πιο πετυχημένος κυβερνήτης στις πολιτείες των Ηνωμένων Πολιτειών όλες. Ήταν ο άνθρωπος που πήρε μια διεφθαρμένη και καταραίουσα, μια διεφθαρμένη πολιτική κοινότητα που ήταν η Μασαχουσέτη. Το βλέπουμε σε αμερικανικές ταινίες. They're all about Boston and corruption in Boston, right? Πήρε μια διεφθαρμένη πολιτική κοινότητα και την εξυγίανε, με τη δύναμη του παραδείγματός του κυρίως, και πήρε μια καταραίουσα τοπική οικονομία και την απογείωσε. Η Μασαχουσέτη έγινε το θαύμα των Ηνωμένων Πολιτειών. Αυτό τον έκανε υποψήφιο πρόεδρο, δεν ήταν αρκετό για να τον κάνει πρόεδρο. Αυτή η ικανότητα, δηλαδή αυτή η προσπάθεια να βρεις μια ισορροπία ανάμεσα στο economic growth και το social cohesion, γιατί στα χρόνια όταν η Μασαχουσέτη που άφησε πίσω το Δουκάκης, στατιστικά, ήταν όχι μόνο η ταχύτερα αναπτυσσόμενη οικονομία των ΗΠΑ, αλλά και η πολιτεία των ΗΠΑ, όπου ο δείκτης οικονομικής και εισοδηματικής ανισότητας ήταν χαμηλότερος παρά παντού αλλού. Τέξας, νομίζω ότι το Τέξας ήταν ο πρωταθλητής, η πολιτεία με τον υψηλότερο, αυτό το περίφημο coefficient του income inequality, και η Μασαχουσέτη ήταν η πολιτεία με τον χαμηλότερο. Και αυτό είναι δύο ιδιότητες του Δουκάκη που νομίζω ότι έχουν σημασία και για το σημερινό, ας πούμε, για τη σημερινή πολιτική συζήτηση.
I'll reveal something. I turn on the TV to watch your commentary on Greek politics.
Oh, yeah?
If, as a journalist, think...
You just say to flatter me.
Well, that's a good part of it. I'm a consensus builder. We're building bridges here, but I don't watch television very much. But I really like the way you talk about politics. If you're covering Michael Dukakis as a journalist in 1988, what are you saying to the Greek public? Aside from your personal reflections here, what is the professional going to say? What is the journalist? How are you going to frame the presentation of this candidate?
I would raise the question. He's a great guy. He can change the United States in 4 years' time. But his views, his personal philosophy, the way he lives, is so far away from what middle America thinks and believes in, that it is almost impossible to win election on a national level.
An unelectable candidate, in other words.
And a terrific, it would, if by a miracle he would could be elected, that would be great. I'm not sure that, when I asked him, and he said he was making a joke, that is, or he is to blame for what has gone wrong with the United States and the world, but I think he would have made a difference. But I'm not sure he could have been elected with that question in the second debate or not.
Okay. Or the helmet, or the other issues about how he ran his campaign. Yeah, quite interesting. Now, it is said that Michael Dukakis became Greek for the purpose of running that campaign. Mm-hmm. So he ran as the son of immigrants mm-hmm. who happened to be from Greece. Is that part of the profile that one sees here, that his parents were actually born in Greece? His mother was born in Larissa, very close by. You mentioned Mytilene. I think he has family also in Epirus, all over Greece, literally. But that's how he framed his campaign, and that's what we were told. Did that play into the way Greeks were looking at what was happening in 1988?
Yeah, sure. Oh, sure, yes. That was the big story. A Greek-American, someone with rooted with Greek origins and deeply rooted in, with a mother that is called Efterpi.
Who else in the United States has that name today?
Mother called Efterpi and very, very active during his campaign. She was there. Yeah. But that was a very big story. I'm not sure. Did that help in running for office in the United States at the time?
If you were Italian, perhaps.
If you were Italian.
Mario Cuomo might have brought his mother.
And that might work, yeah.
Dinas ya to George Bush, to Patera.
He was better than his son,
I think.
He's not someone I would have voted for, but I admit he's better than his son. And the way he treated the Middle East crisis and the first war in Iraq, compared to how his son managed the second war in Iraq, or mismanaged the second war in Iraq, there's a difference there.
Here's the question for this reason, maybe two. First of all, here is a career public servant, like Michael Dukakis, a career public servant, a person who served and has an ethos of service that I think his son lacked. We also have a habit of thinking in particular that the foreign policy of George H.W. Bush was successful. Reunification of Germany, stayed out of the Yugoslav crisis, for better or worse, managed the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait. I mean, when you look at those three things and you look at what transpired prior and after, this is a success story. This is a guy who ran a tight ship in terms of his foreign policy.
On the one hand, he was lucky. I mean, nobody had planned, and nobody would have predicted that night, October 1989, in Berlin, something like that would have happened. It happened by accident. Maybe it would have happened at some point in time, but it happened during his term. Yeah. He didn't make a mess out of it. He handled it in a way that was successful and avoided all the disasters that might have come out of it. Yes, but he was also lucky. Του συνέβη κάτι κοσμοϊστορικό στη διάρκεια της θητείας του, το οποίο δεν προκάλεσε ο ίδιος. Okay. Προς το έτυχε. Το χειρίστηκε όμως καλά, νομίζω. Το χειρίστηκε δηλαδή με έναν τρόπο... ήταν μια πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα εμπειρία αυτή. Νομίζω 20 χρόνια από την πτώση του τείχου του Βερολίνου το 2009, έγινε στο Βερολίνο μία συνάντηση. Ήταν ο Τζορτζ Μπους, ο Χέλμουντ Κολ και ο Μιχαήλ Γκορμπατσόφ. Και συζητούσαν μεταξύ τους και δέχονταν ερωτήσεις από δημοσιογράφους, στον βαθμό που ήταν σε θέση να δεχτούν, ο Κολ ήδη δεν ήταν σε θέση να δεχτεί, ο Μπους και ο Γκορμπατσόφ ήταν, για το τι συνέβη το 1989 και πώς εκείνοι οι τρεις το χειρίστηκαν, γιατί ήταν οι τρεις πρωταγωνιστές ενός κοσμοϊστορικού γεγονότος.
Who's the one to matter?
George Bush, Μιχάλη Γκορμπατσόφ, Χέλμουντ Κόλ. Και μου έκανε εντύπωση ότι ο Γκορμπατσόφ πολλές φορές στη διάρκεια αυτής της συζήτησης αναγνώρισε στον Bush statesmanship, goodwill, honesty and efficiency. So, well, if Gorbachev says so, I mean, okay, we have to accept that he might be right.
He might be right, okay. So you think now, looking back a little bit, are we justified in looking at the moral character of a personage like Michael Dukakis and comparing it to the occupant of the White House currently? Is that a fair thing to do? Is it something that would make sense journalistically, for example?
Oh, yeah, sure. Just to footnote to what I said before, I was there in this debate between the three leaders of 1989, and I had my question, and I was raising my hand to put the question, but I didn't have the chance. There was about 300 journalists in the room, and I wasn't the lucky one. Well, as it became obvious, I've never been a fan of George W. Bush, the son. But if you compare George W. Bush to the present occupant of the White House, he looks like a statesman of caliber. And say something that he made it obvious that he is not supporting Donald Trump. So if the comparison is so favorable for George W. Bush, think about Michael Dukakis. Αλλά ξαναγυρίζουμε σε μια συζήτηση. Είχαμε για πολλά χρόνια συνηθίσει στον κινησμό της πολιτικής, ότι η πολιτική είναι μια τεχνική της εξουσίας και μια μαεστρία της επικοινωνίας. Φτιάχνεις ένα team ανθρώπων που ξέρουν καλά τη μηχανική της εξουσίας, τα γρανάζια, και να τα ταιριάζουν μεταξύ τους, και ένα team ανθρώπων που ξέρουν να χρησιμοποιούν το Twitter, το Facebook, τα social media γενικά, όλα τα μέσα, και να φτιάχνουν εικόνα, να αποδομούν τον αντίθετο λόγο, να χτυπάνε το συνέστημα, να χτυπάνε λίγο κάτω από τη μέση, τον μέσο ψηφοφόρο. Πού μας έχει φτάσει αυτό?
Εντάξει, μία ερώτηση. We'll ask one more question and then we'll watch a little interview that I taped some months ago with Michael Dukakis via Skype, try to communicate as often as we can. First of all, I'd say about Michael Dukakis, he will have met you once, 30, 40 years ago, and remembered you, remembered who
Absolutely.
You are.
I met him in 1999 and in 2008, I walked in, no, this in university, he says, hi, how are you doing? I remember we met.
If you could have asked him a question at any time that maybe wasn't asked, what would that question be?
Oh, I have to think it over. No, I can't answer that.
Okay.
I have to think about it, yeah.
Okay.
So I usually, after I do an interview, for the days and weeks that come, I say, I should have asked that. It didn't happen with Dukakis, no. There's not a question that comes in my mind. But
to jump ahead a little bit, how would you define the phrase public service? Ista Anglika. Είμαστε the Dukakis Center for Public Service. Τι έννοια έχει?
Για μένα έχει την έννοια της... Έχει την ίδια έννοια που έχει ο ορισμός του πολίτη στον επιτάφιο του Περικλή. Δηλαδή, την αυτονόητη υποχρέωση ενός πολίτη να συμμετέχει στα κοινά και να αναλαμβάνει την ευθύνη του, έστω και απλώς ψηφίζοντας. Για μένα αυτή είναι Αυτόν τον ορισμό θα έδινε έτσι πρόχειρα.
In English, there's a translation of the funeral oration. It's a spirit of reverence in our public acts. You realize that you're doing something beyond the norm when you're in public dealing with other people. Let's take a brief pause here, and I'll load up the video clip. It's a couple minute video clip, an interview we did with Michael Dukakis. You know, the last time he visited Greece, he had an accident in the airplane, and he had a problem with one of his eyes and was almost blinded. A team of Greek doctors took care of him, and he has vision again. It's a bit of a miracle. It's the Greek miracle, like there was a Massachusetts miracle. But we talked a little about that. Here, I asked him questions about what being a public servant meant to him. The answers may sound familiar to you. And then what was it that led him to the career path that he took? Why would a young person in his day and age, or why would a young person today decide that they want somehow to be involved in what we call in English public affairs? So let me load this up and we'll take a look. With a question. So I wanted to ask you a little bit about the personal appeal that public service has had for you in your long lifetime as a public servant.
Well, I don't know of anything that one can do in this world that is more personally fulfilling and satisfying than being in a position where you can make a real difference in the lives of your fellow citizens. And I see that as what politics at its best is all about. And I've had the great good fortune to be able to do that in my entire life, both in politics and now teaching public policy and remaining still very active in public affairs, both here in Massachusetts and nationally. And these days I get enormous satisfaction from being able to teach and guide, mentor lots and lots of terrific young people, both here and at UCLA in the wintertime, who I hope and expect are going to be the next generation of public leaders. Mm-hmm. And I know you're trying to do exactly the same kind of thing at Anatolia and ACT, and it's as wonderful a life as one could have. Never regretted it for a minute. I'm sorry I didn't make it to the White House. I didn't really
know. Well, that's all right. I don't think you would have been able to make me breakfast if you were in the White House, so...
In any event, as I often say, we'd have been dancing the Sabbath on the White House.
Right.
Should have been something.
What was it?
I think it's a wonderful life. And one of the things I try, which you know very hard to help my students understand, is that you can do it while setting high standards for integrity for yourself and people that work for you. And I'd like to think that's something not only I've been able to do, but I think and I hope I've been able to encourage lots of my students and the people who work with me to do that. It's not difficult to set high standards of integrity and live by them, and at the same time do good things in public life. And I can't think of a better life. And after all, it was the ancient Greeks that first told us, right? That the single most important thing one could do and be was to be an active citizen in one's city, one's city state, and so forth. And nothing has changed in that regard.
Yeah. What was it for you personally that sort of was the snap or the spark? You said, I'm going to get involved in the way that you did. There was some, I think, family history, a little bit of politics, but as a young person...
Remember, my parents were both immigrants. They both came over here at a relatively young age, back in 1912 and 1913.
Yeah.
Young Greek immigrants weren't going into politics in those days. They were just trying to support themselves and their families. In the case of my parents, get an education, which was quite unusual. My mother was the first Greek American woman ever to go away to college in the history of the United States. And that was very unusual at the time. This 90-year-old girl from Lysa, who comes to Havel, Massachusetts, and ends up at Bates College. And so it wasn't so much that, but I did have parents who, while not politically active, took world affairs seriously.
Okay.
And they expected their kids to take it seriously.
Mm-hmm.
But there are lots of other, I mean, why did I run for the presidency of my third grade class at the Baker School in Massachusetts? Why did my classmates elect me? I don't know.
Yeah.
But I will tell you that years later, when I became governor, I called that third grade teacher, who was still teaching, by the way, out of Grand Massachusetts. I said, Mrs. Ripley, this is the guy who got started in elected politics. How would you like to bring your class down to the governor's office and visit? I had a basketball coach, you know, who happened to be Kitty's own teacher over at that time. You know, we didn't know each other.
Mm-hmm.
And he was the first adult who said to me, he hated Joe McCarthy, he couldn't stand McCarthy. Dukakis, someday you want to run for elected office. And that was the first adult that ever said that to me.
Okay.
These interesting influences, maybe that have an impact on your life. And so, it's a combination of things. I was taught that this was a country that believed deeply in justice and civil rights, and yet I grew up in a segregated society.
Right.
That didn't make a lot of sense to me.
Yeah.
So, hold on, Dave, just a sec. John, could you close that door? I'm talking to people in Greece. Close the door.
We'll stop the clip there. There's a bit of a problem with the sound. Anyway, I thought this would be an opportunity, having listened to that, to open the floor to comments or questions. We have two interns with the wireless microphones who will pass among you. Identify yourselves, and you can ask a question in Greek or in English, whatever is your pleasure. And let's maybe reflect a little bit on what we've heard. I'll ask Pavlos to sum up his thoughts about this clip in particular.
The idea of facing Hasapiko in the White House.
I mentioned that we have students from around the United States, some 350, who are attending classes at ACT this semester. We have students from I don't know how many countries actually attending classes here, taking degrees. And I saw a gal of Oriental origin, and I said, well, can you imagine how you would feel if a Chinese American ran for president of the United States? And it may happen in my lifetime. It will certainly happen in the young people's lifetimes. It's quite extraordinary to think about. Questions or comments at this point? Anyone want to reflect a little bit on what Michael Dukakis may have meant to you? I was speaking with someone in the audience who said he was in the United States in 1988. Would you like to share that story a little bit?
Yep, I was studying in the United States.
Hi, I'm Evita Gandina. I'm an adjunct professor here. I was studying in the United States back in 1988. I was in Houston, Texas. And back then, in Houston, people loved Bush. I still love him, the whole family. Even I was close to the Greek community, going to church and everything, and they would find every single excuse not to like Dukakis. His wife is not Greek, she's not Greek Orthodox, he doesn't speak good Greek, he has an accent, just name it. Bush was not from Houston, but he was, during the election, he was there, at the convention center, and even Greeks would not even bother to vote for Dukakis.
Do we have a similar story over here? Some other gentleman told me he was in the United States. Sir, would you like to share your story?
Hi. I was there in 1988, and I was in Wisconsin-Madison. It was like a liberal state. And it was one of the states that Dukakis won. I think he won in 11 states. And one was Wisconsin. I was in his speech when he came to Madison twice, and we didn't have a very great, big actually, Greek community, but all the people liked him. As I told you, it was a liberal state, but unfortunately, it's a very small state, so they only have only like 11 electoral votes. So actually, it didn't matter that much. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. He may have won California. Ruth, did you have something you wanted to add back there? Ruth Sutton, a former instructor here at ACT, adjunct professor.
Hi, thanks. I'd like to just share a more contemporary experience. When I was teaching here, my students were working on a project that they conceived of themselves through the Dukakis Center. And Mr. Dukakis came and spoke with the students, and they used the preposition very carefully. He spoke with the students. He didn't talk at them. He didn't talk to them. He asked them questions. He listened to them. He even sat on a recycled chair that a group of five-year-olds had made with complete trust. None of the rest of us trusted it. He sat in a recycled chair. I was very impressed by that. But he didn't engage with all of the so-called important people around him. He was interested in the students, and he was interested in what they had to say, not just telling them things. And that made a huge impression on me, because it's extremely rare for a politician.
Ruth, hold the microphone for a moment. You oversaw the execution of two major projects some couple years ago, at a time that we were gearing the young people to sort of design their own projects and take ownership of some contribution to society. How did you and how do you now define public service?
Big pause. Hold on a minute.
Okay, I'm done. I've got Pavlos and I've got Ruth. I'm two for two right now.
I'm not on the same level. I would say something a little bit more every day than an epigraph on a tombstone. I would say that if you're in a society and you have your needs met and you have your rights, it's kind of your responsibility to engage in public service. So I would say it's a huge honor to be part of organizations and be part of projects that can perform public services, but I would say it's something very, very every day. The issue of picking up litter when you walk around with, you know, you're walking through the streets, carry a plastic bag, pick up litter. I would define that as public service, just kind of everyday responsibilities.
He does it, and I read the same story, and he meets the young people at the train station, and they say, "What are you doing?" He said, "Do you know who I am? I was your governor." How many governors, how many ex or former governors do you meet picking up litter, caring about the cleanliness of public spaces? How many Greek politicians have ever done such things? Maybe you pick something up from the, you know, the Skilatico when you go out for a political event, something like that. Thoughts or comments on what you've heard?
One thing. I like the answer. Okay. That reminded me of an example somebody produced some time ago, many years ago. He said, you're in a theater and there's a fire or an earthquake. People panic and scream. The stronger they look for an exit. But some people would say, would look around and would try to find a way to help all the people in the room get out safely. Well, that's public service in a way. Not caring about how I get out as quick as I can, but no, I shouldn't get out as quick as I can because there's a bunch of people here and I have to help them. I think this is also a good definition of what public service might be.
Let's segue to our second clip now. This is a slightly longer video clip. It's an excerpt from the documentary that the couple young men over here are producing for me. And I want to say it's been an incredible experience for me, because when you talk with people, you assume that they don't know anything about what you do. Then you start to listen to them and realize that they actually have something to teach you. And that would be maybe the theme of what we're trying to communicate this year at the Dukakis Center. It's not about me sharing my mastery of public administration or telling you that you can be ethical and you don't have to sell out. It's about communicating a sense of trust that you can say something to me that's meaningful, and I would go into a conversation or exchange with you thinking that I can learn something from you. It's certainly been the case with Dimitris Savvaidis, who's engaged in really remarkable sorts of activities that we would call public service. Dimitri had to duck out for another engagement. And Asterios, who see these, who's working the cameras now, has understood that what he's doing in producing this documentary is a kind of public service. It's inside of every individual, is what I would say to a young person. It's there. We'll just ask you to share it, and perhaps you have something more to teach us. We'll come back to the discussion after we watch this second video.
There is nothing you can do in this world more fulfilling and more satisfying. Giving of yourself to others and making a contribution to your community and your state and your nation and your fellow citizens.
On March 16, 1987, Michael S. Dukakis, governor of Massachusetts, announced his candidacy for the presidency of the United States. A little over a year later, Dukakis won the nomination of the Democratic Party, but was defeated in the general election by George H.W. Bush. In his concession speech on Election Day, Dukakis had a special message for the many young people who had supported his campaign. "I hope many of you will go into politics and public service," he said. "It is a noble profession, noble profession." When he completed his final term as governor and retired from public life, Dukakis returned to his previous vocation of college professor. In this way, in September 1999, Michael and Kitty Dukakis visited ACT, the American College of Thessaloniki, to inaugurate what was to become the Dukakis Center. As we enter our 20th season of public service initiatives at the Dukakis Center, we celebrate the spirit and legacy of this great American public servant. This is our story.
Second day of deliberations tomorrow to draft a democratic charter for Europe.
purpose of your debates the next 2 days is to try to decide what kind of democracy you want for Europe, what democracy will look like in the next 10, 20, 30 years in your Europe.
Our future depends on how effectively we inspire coming generations to involve themselves in public affairs, how enthusiastic they can become about the task of collective decision making, how well we can learn to listen and appreciate what they have to teach us, their peers and their elders. The Dukakis Center was launched in 1999 as an endowed chair and transformed in 2011 into a full-fledged university center. In that time, the Dukakis Center has organized and hosted hundreds of public events and educational activities in Thessaloniki and beyond. One of three dedicated outreach centers at ACT, the tertiary division of Anatolia, the Dukakis Center is the proud standard bearer of Anatolia's century and a half long commitment to civic and social responsibility.
And civic awareness. The Dukakis Center clearly allows us to realize this mission for our students and beyond, because the center allows us to have a direct communication and linkage to our community here. The role of the university is to prepare the citizens of tomorrow in every aspect, no matter what the students study. They have to be equipped and ready to become productive members of their respective communities.
It's a place where young people who have not lost themselves in despair, who have hope for the future, who want to do constructive and useful things, come to figure out for themselves the best way to do that, the best way to be of service to the people in their community. The only way you understand what public service is by doing public service. And the center is the place you come to start doing public service so that you understand it and it becomes a value that you hold dear yourself.
In America, I started volunteering at a young age, mostly for selfish reasons. And it was an organization where you would volunteer to mentor sixth graders that were from unprivileged areas of town. They're the ones who got in trouble with the law, the ones who committed crimes, or the ones who skipped school and had bad grades. And they're under the name Robert. And before Robert, I really didn't care too much about anyone but myself. It was more just getting to college and doing a job. Robert had his father left when he was young, and he didn't really have a father figure in his life. And I was a 19-year-old selfish kid who didn't really, I don't know how to tell a young man, you know, why he should be ethical or why he should try to go to college when his parents didn't. And that was my first real experience where I wanted to actually make a change, make a difference. So for me, we started talking about grades, and I worked with him an hour a week for 4 years. His grades have improved, he stopped getting in fights, he stopped getting suspended. And I mean, it changed my outlook a lot.
ACT subscribes to a pedagogy of experience and learning, of learning by doing. For 20 years, the Dukakis Center has been a pioneer in the development of innovative learning activities on and off campus, master classes, academic simulations, study trips and diplomatic tours, debates, blogging, television programming, internships on and off campus, and a wide variety of student-designed civil society projects. Our mission also calls for us to engage actively with the local community and our diverse constituencies. Thus, the Center hosts a wide variety of major public events annually, including lectures, seminars, conferences, roundtables, and book presentations featuring prominent practitioners, scholars, and publicists. Topics have ranged from foreign policy to sustainable development, from historical remembrance to creativity. The Center's flagship program is the renowned series of Dukakis lectures, which feature high-profile speakers, often in exclusive appearances on and off campus, occasionally in collaboration with other institutions in Greece and abroad. The common thread in all these activities is a commitment to inspiring youth to take up active roles in public affairs.
Despite the fact that in every project there are loads of obstacles, the entire process of watching the students come up with an idea and actually put it into practice successfully is hugely enjoyable. It's exhausting, but seeing students actually not be quite sure at the beginning, like, can we actually do this? Seeing them take responsibility, seeing them come up with amazing ideas, seeing them overcome problems, and in the end produce something which is much, much bigger and better than we could have hoped is just fantastic. The two main projects, one of that I can think about that really kind of reflect this, illustrate this. First one's the Recycle Monster, in which students came up with a fantastic idea to spread environmental awareness by going around schools and encouraging children not to sit down and learn a whole load of things by heart about the environment, but to create art, monster art, out of trash. The other one was a project called Street Kid to School Kid. And it was a very ambitious project, and in the end we couldn't do the entirety of it because it involved many months of social research that we didn't have time for within the scope of the course. But the idea was to raise awareness and kind of empathy, but not sympathy necessarily, not pity, for kids who are...
Bring disgrace to this our country by any act of dishonesty or of cowardice. We will fight for the ideals of this our country. We will revere and obey the law. We will strive to quicken our sense of civic duty. Thus, in all these ways, we will transmit this country greater, stronger, prouder, and more beautiful than it was transmitted to us.
Okay, we're here now to the second segment, where we'll reverse roles, and I'll invite our guest speaker to be the guest inquisitor, and we'll tell you a little bit about the Dukakis Center and some impressions that you may have coming here.
Γιατί διάλεξε το Dukakis, δηλαδή Ανατόλια, ACT, γιατί προσκαλέσατε το Dukakis να αναμειχθεί στο εκπαιδευτικό πρόγραμμα, το Dukakis και όχι κάποιον άλλο.
Excellent question. The office of the Board of Trustees of Anatolia College is located in Boston, across the street from the State House. Certain members of the Board of Trustees were personally acquainted with Michael Dukakis, a prominent Hellene, Greek-American. It was a natural approach. A Greek-American, someone who would have visibility in Boston, in the Northeast, in the United States generally, but it could also be a statement for what we stand for, what we aspire to stand for. It was chance, in a way. You mentioned, you know, the fall of the Berlin Wall. Well, this was our chance. And he was, I think, genuinely honored by the invitation, and he supported us, as you see.
That's what I wanted to ask. What was really his first reaction when he was approached?
I can't say. My first meeting was before your first meeting. So I met him first, and then you did the interview. I mean, it was really in that same interval of a couple of weeks in September 1999. I can only tell you, and we were with Fotini at the time, we approached him, and he engaged us for a 15-20 minute conversation. The room was full of other people that he's going to get to in his time, but he had time to learn about us, to see what we were doing. It's an extension of who he is. He had left public life in 1991. That was the end of his term as governor. And he started lecturing casually in a variety of places throughout the United States. And then he was invited by the then president of Northeastern University, whose name I don't recall, to have a presidential position, a presidential lecture or something like that, honorary president. And I'll tell you this, he works more at 82 than I work at 102. I mean, the guy is incredible. He walks to work every day, or he takes public transportation, the weather's a little inclement. He sits in the office, he grades papers, he just sits with his students, and then he goes and teaches. And when he's not doing that, he's involved in all kinds of other things. Quite, and I think that it was an extension. It was a way for him really to become Greek in a way that he wasn't able to prior. He'd come to Greece. And he's traveled and visited Greece a couple of times subsequently, as you've mentioned.
That's one of the most astonishing things about him. We know many academics that went into politics, but I don't recall anybody, after having such a high caliber political career, reaching high office, turning back to an academic career. Usually ex-presidents, ex-governors, ex-politicians do the lecture tour.
Think tanks. Think tanks is a big thing for us, and it's too. Very lucrative.
Yeah,
but you don't really do much. You might write an article, an op-ed. You go on a speaking tour. Mm-hmm. You're paid $100,000. Yeah. I think the going price for an ex-president like Bill Clinton is $100,000. If you were Bill Clinton, I would have to fork over $100,000. Mm-hmm. Not for Michael. He does it for free.
That's it. And then he goes every day to his office at the university, and he really teaches. He goes into class and do class every day. That's an amazing thing about him. Have you ever thought that someone else might be better as a namesake?
That's above my pay grade. But I will say this. There is a tradition in the United States that, let's say, a retiring public official will lend his name to a university program. I'm thinking, you know, there's the Bush School, Texas. They're almost a dime a dozen, and they're everywhere. Colin Powell, somewhere in New York City, has a program named after him. So that's not so unusual. And the idea of approaching Michael Dukakis was also, I think, the spur to Northeastern proposing to create a center which focuses on urban and public policy. So there's a sister institution now at Northeastern. It's not uncommon. Governors, especially in the executive branch of the United States at the state or federal level, is not uncovered. Or you have a senator, for example, who lends his name to his alma mater.
Okay. You've been around for 20 years. This is a project that has been going on for 20 years. Can you mention one, two, three things that you're proud of?
An event we did with the late Chris and Nicolari. You saw footage in this video that was done by her brother, Christos Nicolaris, the film producer. He did a master class in filmmaking with us, and the students actually produced some of the footage that will be in the documentary. Chrissa, at the same time, it was the spring semester of 2014, did a master class in photography. She came up with the idea that we would send students to shadow candidates in the local and European elections. She trained them. We approached the different candidates. They agreed. We set the students loose. They organized an exhibition of the photographs at the port annex of the National Museum of Contemporary Art back in, I think, May or June of 2014. I'm really proud of that one. I'm proud of the two projects that Ruth's students did, because from beginning to end, they were student-designed, student-led projects. And those are the kinds of things, above all, that are most meaningful for me, and I think for the students as well. And there are many others. We've done countless lectures. Every day is a bigger number. That's how countless it is. But these are the kinds of things that really stand out for me.
And όταν είστε σε επαφή με τους φοιτητές, στις καθηγητές, στα μαθήματα, στις εργασίες, στις δραστηριότητες, τι είναι αυτό που αισθάνεστε απέναντι στο πίσω από το public and humanitarian service? Υπάρχει το politics, in a way. Τι είναι αυτό που αισθάνεστε και στη διάρκεια αυτών των 20 χρόνων πώς έχει αλλάξει αυτό που αισθάνεστε ότι είναι στο μυαλό τους για την πολιτική? Τι είναι για αυτούς η πολιτική?
Okay. It's a good question, and allow me to say a few things about the academic program here. Initially, the idea was the Dukakis Center would supplement studies in a new field of study in international relations. The international relations program at ACT is 20 years old. Also, my chair, Dr. Maria Kirikidou, was in the audience a short while ago. We train leaders. That's what we do. But it's not an academic sort of training. We help people realize that they have leadership qualities. Okay, you can take a humble man like Michael Dukakis and say, well, there's some leadership characteristic in his personality, and I can be that way. Michael says, and you saw in the clip, you can be decent and honest, and avoid corruption, and still do something good. Over time, that, for me, has been a core message. We send young people into the world. You know, the element of trust that I was alluding to a little while ago is precisely that. I trust you guys are gonna, you're gonna be there when we need you to be there, the next generation.
And my question was, do you feel they're interested? Do you think that you persuade them that you can be decent, honest, avoid corruption, and still be in politics?
I tell you what, let's let them answer. Tarek? The question as put by our guest.
Take some time to figure it out. Oh, yes. So yeah, I'm an intern in the Khaki Center. This is my third semester as being an intern. And it's been a great pleasure working with Dr. Wisner and cooperating with the experts that we had opportunity to. Through all these semesters, we have hosted one of the most influential experts, not only from the Balkans and Europe, but from the United States as well. And yes, of course, I'm motivated and interested in taking a step toward engaging actually in politics and making changes, let's say.
Okay. Is Gordon still here? There you
are. Hi everyone, my name is Gordon and I'm also an intern of the Dukakis Center. I started interning 4 years ago when I started my college, and it has been since then a pleasure to me to be on every event and volunteer by myself. For Dukakis Center, I would say that it changed my way of life and my perspective about the politics and about democracy and about everything else that we as human beings need to do for our community. So I encourage everyone, from the students present here, because it's our last year being here, to be encouraged and volunteer as much as they can, because in the end, that stays forever.
There you are. I do. We have final guest this evening is a student at the high school, Anatolia College. As I mentioned to his parents a short while ago, we have from time to time hosted groups of students to come down and do individual activities. But the good offices of Ariane Kotze, the guidance counselor at Anatolia, we decided this time we would host a high school student for an entire academic year as an intern, to give him one or two or three projects and to join our events and actually to contribute and tell him what he thinks is an extension of our fundamental mission. So I'd like to invite George to come up. He's prepared a little bit to chat with you.
Τι σε έκανε να δεχτείς την πρόταση?
Βασικά δεν ήταν τόσο πρόταση όσο μια δυνατότητα. Εγώ θέλω να πάω να σπουδάσω στην Αμερική. Και η δυνατότητα του να εξοικειωθώ και με το ακαδημαϊκό σύστημα της Αμερικής, καθώς πήρα ένα summer class στο ACT φέτος το καλοκαίρι, και να γνωρίσω περισσότερο, ξέρω, αυτό το αμερικανικό... να εξοικειωθώ με την αμερικανική πολιτική σκηνή, να γνωρίσω τον τρόπο σκέψης στα αμερικανικά πανεπιστήμια και να κάνω αυτό το internship progress που όλοι οι περισσότεροι αμερικανικοί μαθητές περνάνε. Είναι κάτι το οποίο πραγματικά ήταν μια δυνατότητα, όχι πρόταση, την οποία πρέπει να σκεφτώ για να δεχτώ να σας πω να δει.
Όταν αποφάσισες να πάρεις αυτή, να εκμεταλλευτείς αυτή τη δυνατότητα, το όνομα Μάικλ Δουκάκης τι σημαίνει για σένα, τι έλεγε για σένα?
Πολύ αόριστα και πολύ ασαφή. Ένας άνθρωπος πολιτικός, γνωστός, τίποτα περισσότερο. Δεν ήξερα περί τίνος πρόκειται. Ξέρω, μπαίνοντας μέσα στο Dukakis Center, you have to look up what Michael Dukakis is, so... και έμαθα έτσι τα πράγματα, το ποιος ήταν, τι έκανε, το έργο του, τι προσπάθησε να επιτύχει, τι κατάφερε από αυτά, τι κάνει σήμερα. Και απλά το ένα πράγμα το οποίο ξεχώρισε για μένα σε όλο αυτό, σε όλη αυτή την καριέρα την πολιτική, ήταν ότι ένας γιος μεταναστών πρώτης γενιάς μπόρεσε να επιτύχει κάτι τόσο μεγάλο, δηλαδή μόνο το να πάρει το χρήσμα των δημοκρατικών, ένα από τα δύο μεγάλα κόμματα στην Αμερική για την Προεδρία, είναι κάτι το απίστευτο. Και μόνο το ότι μπόρεσε να το επιτύχει αυτό, είναι αυτή η ελπίδα που πιστεύω ότι δίνει ακόμα και σήμερα με τα υπέρ και τα κατά της Αμερική σε όλο τον κόσμο. Και αυτό είναι το ένα πράγμα το οποίο με γέμισε ελπίδα και χαρά που προσφέρω και εγώ σε αυτό το Dukakis Center.
Αυτό που είπε προηγουμένως ο Ντέιβιντ, ότι το μήνυμα του Dukakis δηλαδή, ότι μπορείς να είσαι στην πολιτική και να μην τρέπεσαι. Ότι μπορείς να είσαι έντιμος, αξιοπρεπής, πιστός στις ιδέες σου και παρόλα αυτά να είσαι στην πολιτική και να μην είσαι μοιραία αποτυχημένος στην πολιτική. Σε πείθει, δηλαδή.
Ιδεολογικά, ναι. Πραγματιστικά όμως είναι δύσκολο για τους νέους της εποχής μας και μου συμπληρώνουν να το συνειδητοποιήσουν αυτό. Το λέει στα βιβλία, το βλέπουμε στα ντοκιμαντέρ, αλλά είναι δύσκολο να το δεις στην πραγματικότητα. Δηλαδή, ανοίγεις να δεις τις ειδήσεις και βλέπουμε εσάς να σχολιάζετε όλα τα κατά που έχει η σημερινή πολιτική σκηνή στην Ελλάδα, στην Ευρώπη, στον κόσμο, χωρίς τις αξίες, χωρίς την ετοιμότητα, χωρίς το public service. Νιώθεις ότι η πολιτική του σήμερα, νιώθω εγώ προσωπικά, ότι αυτοί έχουν την εντύπωση ότι ο λαός τους οφεί. Οπότε εγώ, η άποψή μου για το public service είναι ότι πρέπει να είναι όντως service. Δηλαδή, πρέπει εσύ να προσφέρεσαι στο λαό, να δίνεσαι με όλους σου το είναι. Και χωρίς να έχεις απαραίτητα κάτι να κερδίσεις. Ο Μάικλ Δουκάκης έχασε την Προεδρία και ακόμα βλέπουμε ότι δεν έχει το παραμικρό ίχνος μη θέληση να προσφέρει.
Και επίσης, ίσως και το παραμικρό έθνος πικρίας, δεν είμαι σίγουρος, αλλά δεν δείχνει πάντως να αντιμετωπίζει την ήττα του με πικρία, την αντιμετωπίζει με πολύ ανοιχτό τρόπο. Αυτό που είπες προηγουμένως για το βλέπεις εμάς το βράδυ να σχολιάζουμε, νομίζω ότι θα πρέπει οι δημοσιογράφοι να κάνουν κάπως αλλιώς τη δουλειά τους όταν παρακολουθούν και καλύπτουν την πολιτική.
Τώρα για εσάς, άμα είναι να πω.
Όχι, δεν θέλω να πω.
Όχι, αυτό που ήθελα να πω είναι ότι η δουλειά του σχολιαστή στις ειδήσεις, όπως στο SKAI, είναι πολύ ξεκάθαρη όταν είναι σχολιαστής. Η δουλειά του ρεπορτάζ, γιατί και η δημοσιογραφία είναι κάτι το οποίο με ενδιαφέρει πολύ, η δουλειά του ρεπορτάζ είναι πολύ διαφορετική από τη δουλειά του παρουσιαστή ή του σχολιαστή. Από ό,τι έχω δει, τα προβλήματα δημιουργούνται όταν το ρεπορτάζ και ο σχολιασμός αρχίζει να μπλέκεται το ένα με το άλλο, όταν οι γραμμές δεν είναι τόσο διακριτές. Αλλά αυτό νομίζω ότι είναι το πρόβλημα, δεν νομίζω ότι είναι τόσο μεγάλο ή σοβαρό.
Τώρα για να σου πω και εγώ κάτι εξομολογητικό. Το σχόλιο στο δελτίο ειδήσεων ποτέ δεν μ' άρεσε ιδιαίτερα. Το ξεκίνησα από σύμπτωση. Δηλαδή, ήμουν στο ΜΕΚΑ, έκανα μια εκπομπή έρευνας η οποία απαιτούσε μέσα πολλά resources και είχε ένα κόστος για το κανάλι, που πληρώνει κάμερες, ταξίδια, μοντάζ. Και μου ζητήσαν, OK, θα έχουμε αυτή την εκπομπή, θα την προβάλλουμε σε μια καλή ώρα και θα τη χρηματοδοτούμε, αλλά θέλουμε επίσης να έρχεσαι στο δελτίο ειδήσεων και να κάνεις σχόλιο. Και εγώ το έβλεπα ως μια αγκαρία, ένα trade, ας πούμε, ότι OK, για να μπορώ να κάνω τα ρεπορτάζ που μου αρέσουν, θα έρχομαι και στο δελτίο και θα κάνω πολιτικά σχόλια. Κάποια στιγμή συνειδητοποίησα ότι αυτό που στο μυαλό μου ήταν το δευτερεύον, στην πραγματικότητα, επειδή έτσι είναι η τηλεόραση, είχε γίνει στα μάτια όλου του κόσμου το πρωτεύον. Στα δικά μου μόνο δεν ήταν και εξακολουθεί να μην είναι. Από εκεί και πέρα, ναι, το να υπάρχει ένα σχολιαστής, οπότε και μόνο με τη φυσική του παρουσία, με την αλλαγή των προσώπων, γίνεται σαφές ότι αυτός κάνει σχόλιο. Δεν λέει είδηση. Την είδηση την έχει πει κάποιος άλλος πριν. Νομίζω ότι είναι και, πώς να πω, και συμβολικά και σκηνοθετικά. Υπογραμμίζει αυτό που λες, που νομίζω ότι έχεις απόλυτο δίκιο. Το να ξεχωρίζεις την αφήγηση αυτού που έγινε, έστω υποκειμενική, από το σχόλιο, το συμπέρασμα, την οποιαδήποτε, ας πούμε, σχολιαστική παρέμβαση πάνω στην επαγγελματικότητα. Έχεις πολύ δίκιο σε αυτό. Η παρατήρησή σου μου άρεσε πολύ, είναι πολύ σωστή.
Ευχαριστώ. Okay, shall we pass on, yeah? So, can we have another round of applause for this young man? And maybe this is another thought that I have, and it comes when I reflect on watching you and Sia go back and forth on the evening news, is that, you know, these young people can be incredibly articulate. They kind of know what they want to do. It's rare that you find a person who can't show you a sign that they have an idea what they want to do, and you just open a few doors for them and see what happens. This is a nice opportunity to open the floor to a bit of discussion here. We have plenty of time. Presumably I have a buffet coming, but it won't be here for a bit of time, and we'd like to be able to mingle afterwards. But if somebody would like to make a brief commentary in English or in Greek, you're more than welcome. Can we have the microphone up here? Tarek and Gordon are wearing multiple hats. And you're welcome to interject, and perhaps there will be questions for our speaker.
My name is Fotilia Stradiado, Wisner, and I want to wish David happy anniversary for the Dukakis Center. You worked enormously for the more than 250 events, almost single-handedly, without secretarial support, and I congratulate you for that. And I want to thank you and Dukakis for the transformation I went through all those 20 years, personal transformation, because I did not have a conscious sense of what public service means. And being exposed to the speakers that have been invited all these years, who have contributed with their example, their leadership, and exchanged experiences with the students and the public who participated was for me also a personal experience, because they came to our home and we hosted them and had coffee or dinner together, and that gradually added pieces of the puzzle of a picture that made me actually become self-aware of what I do, what can I do, especially when I became a mother, when I was given the opportunity to contribute to the educational programs of the experimental or pinamatico mitiagogi, where my daughter went. I wrote a paramithi and tried to teach kids values that relate to the Dukakis Center also. And when she was studying politiki agogi at Ekta Dimotiku, we created an educational program. And I thought, not only as a mother, but also as a public servant, trying to encourage other mothers, other parents, to be more active, because I care about two things. One is our kids becoming aware of the fact that when they don't switch the light off, you know, when they don't throw that piece of paper from their candy away at the recycling bin, when they do those things, this is public service, but for the small society called home. When they learn this at home, then when they become whatever they come in society, whether they will think of the common good more naturally than if they don't, if they count on mom to do that or dad, okay? So the other, and why do I say this? Because when it comes to development, economic development, everybody cares about, it would be interesting to see how public service affects the management or leadership among businesses in Greece, and makes you think, why don't we have big Greek companies, more Greek companies in Greece, that function in a team spirit, that actually leads toward the common good of the business advancement, or values that where everybody in the business cares to bring in the extra value that is necessary for the advance the standards that you mentioned, or actually Dukakis mentioned it, elevate the standards, bringing the little extra, act not like a public servant in general, think that, okay, time's up, I have to go, but to think, okay, what else can I do for everybody to advance the pH of the business to become better so that we can all grow into it and through it. So, and when we come to thinking about it in a wider level, in a higher level, thinking of Greece in general and politics, then we're talking about Greece advancing in a level. It's not just ethics, it's a question of a way, of a standard of living. And that's what I would like to have as passed down to the next generation, and to think that this is the most valuable thing we can get from the Dukakis Center. Thank you. Thank you very much.
One of the candidates for on the short list for Michael's vice president was a congressman from Indiana, Lee Hamilton. And something that he said is one of our mottos. Public service is not just a way of life, it's a way of living fully. And I think that's what Putin is saying. Now, is there a way in anyone's mind that we can translate that and put it into action that would be beneficial for Greek society?
It can happen. Υπάρχει ένα παράδειγμα που το έχουμε δει να γίνεται. Είχε πολλές αρνητικές όψεις, αλλά είχε όψεις που ενδεχομένως άφησαν μια αρκετά συκοφαντημένη ή αρνητική εικόνα για αυτό που συνέβη. Αναφέρομαι στο καλοκαίρι του 2004 στην Αθήνα, στη διάρκεια των Ολυμπιακών Αγώνων, όπου υπήρχαν. Έκανα ρεπορτάζ. Είχα μια εκπομπή το βράδυ όπου μιλούσα με τους αθλητές και το διασκέδασα πάρα πολύ. Ήταν η πιο διασκέδαστη δουλειά που κάνω στη ζωή μου. κάθε βράδυ στις 12 η ώρα, όταν είχαν τελειώσει, είχε τελειώσει η ημέρα των Ολυμπιακών Αγώνων, είχα την ευκαιρία να μιλήσω με τα 4-5 πρόσωπα από τον αθλητισμό που είχαν ξεχωρίσει εκείνη την ημέρα. Και επίσης μερικούς από τους παλιούς αθλητές που ήταν εκεί, που ήταν τα ενδάλματά μου όταν εγώ ήμουν νέος. Αλλά πήγαινα κάθε μέρα, όλη μέρα, στα στάδια, έβλεπα αγώνες, έβλεπα όλων των ειδών τα αγωνίσματα και συναντούσα κάθε μέρα ανθρώπους που ήταν εθελοντές. Που ξυπνάγανε σε 6 ώρα το πρωί, ερχόντουσαν από την άλλη άκρη της Αθήνας και στεκόντουσαν εκεί για να κόβουν εισιτήρια, να δίνουν νερά, να βοηθάνε τους ανθρώπους να μπουν στο γήπεδο, στο στάδιο, οι άλλοι να βοηθάνε τους αθλητές. Όλοι χωρίς αμοιβή. Ήταν το πιο μαζικό, εθελοντικό κίνημα που έχει δημιουργηθεί ποτέ στην Ελλάδα, τουλάχιστον από τον πόλεμο και ύστερα. Το έχω ξαναδεί. Και μου είχε κάνει τρομερή εντύπωση η χαρά και η υπερηφάνεια που έβλεπα στα μάτια τους. Οι άνθρωποι ερχόντουσαν εκεί γιατί είχαν πιστέψει ότι αυτό είναι κάτι πολύ σημαντικό για τη χώρα τους, για την πόλη τους και το έκαναν με την καρδιά τους. Εκείνη την ίδια περίοδο, ακόμη και εκείνοι που δεν είχαν δηλωθεί εθελοντές, που ήταν χιλιάδες, δεν ήταν ένας και δύο, ήταν χιλιάδες, ήταν η μοναδική φορά στη ζωή μου που έχω δει την Αθήνα καθαρή, διότι κανείς δεν πετούσε σκουπίδια στο πεζοδρόμιο γιατί ντρεπόταν, έχουμε ξένους. Κανείς δεν έκανε επικίνδυνη οδήγηση στον δρόμο, κανείς δεν έπαιρνε στις λωρίδες, στους δρόμους που είχαν οριστεί ως λωρίδες Ολυμπιακής κυκλοφορίας για να πηγαίνουν γρήγορα. Ήταν ένα θαύμα που κράτησε λίγο, αλλά που άσχετα αν εκ των υστέρων ο μόνος τρόπος για τον οποίο συζητάμε για τους Ολυμπιακούς Αγώνες είναι πόσο κόστησαν, υπήρχε διαφθορά, τι τα κάναμε όλα αυτά τα έργα, ότι δεν είχε συνέχεια, όλα αυτά, τα οποία είναι μέρος της δημόσιας συζήτησης. Για μένα πάντα μένει αυτό το τρομερό παράδειγμα ότι κάτι, έστω και ακόμη και αν πεις ότι ήταν για λάθος λόγο, κάτι όμως κινητοποίησε μερικές δεκάδες χιλιάδες ανθρώπους να αφιερώσουν τη ζωή τους σε κάτι από το οποίο δεν παίρναν τίποτα υλικό, απλώς είχαν τη χαρά ότι ήταν εκεί, συμμετείχαν. Αυτό για μένα είναι ένα πολύ, δηλαδή, στις μέρες που απογοητεύομαι τρομερά και με πιάνει μαύρη απελπισία, όταν το θυμάμαι, χαμογελάω λίγο, λέω, οκ, εντάξει, δεν είναι όλα χαμένα. Απλώς πρέπει να βρεθεί ο τρόπος, πρέπει να βρεθεί ο στόχος και πρέπει να βρεθούν άνθρωποι που να μπορούν να το κινήσουν.
Just interject that ACT in Anatolia sent interview volunteers. We had a team of volunteers, especially some of our foreign students, who worked as translators, and they communicate the same experience. It was once in a lifetime.
Yeah.
Now one hopes that perhaps they carry some of that back with them and other things they do. Oh, okay, and it was a success for all of us who watched, especially for the American women's softball team. But generally speaking, you know, maybe we should host the Olympic Games every 4 years here in Athens. I think it might change.
If we did it every four years.
Okay. Floor is open for other individuals. Vasilis Chrysakis, who's come in, would you like to say something? We have a microphone coming back.
I have
gentleman one here also. Okay.
I have one.
So David,
this is a great initiative. Congratulations. I followed you throughout the years, and it's one of the best initiatives that has happened in the city, in northern Greece, and maybe also even in Greece. We have Elia Mep in the south, and you are in the north. My question is to both. Dukakis is a professor. He became a governor, ran for president, became a professor. So he was coming from academia. Can a life of service, or can a vocation of service emerge mid-career from people who are corporate leaders, who are finance gurus, without having a huge transformation in their lives, like something earth-shattering? It's just that they leave the rest that they're doing, maybe because they made enough, and they actually service in some way their community in a larger or smaller part. Is there something intrinsically prohibiting in a person who has pursued a money direction for very long in doing that? Thanks.
I can't say because that doesn't apply to me personally, but I think in the United States, you wouldn't have to search too far to find examples like that, where people sort of steer in a different direction. Or
maybe it operates for us in terms of philanthropy, that you devote your fortune to a certain cause, for example. I mean, I look at a guy like Warren Buffett, you don't think of Warren Buffett as a great public servant, but he does an awful lot of interesting things, very small things that you wouldn't notice, and he has a philosophy behind it, such you would think this guy is making tons of money, but he's also doing other things that I would call public service. And I think perhaps if we back up for a moment, you realize that public service is a mindset. Both you and I were talking about this morning. You don't realize the little things you do are a public service, right? But they are. And if you just have that moment of realization that this is for some greater good, then it does make a difference for an individual. I don't know if you have a similar experience or whether we could expect in Greece this sort of person having the revelation that they want to contribute to the greater good.
That's part of the Greek history. I mean, Greece was built back in the 19th century by Greeks who were pursuing business careers in Vienna, in Russia, in Egypt, or elsewhere in the world. Athens is full of buildings that were built because some very rich Greek living abroad gave his money away to do it. But if the question is whether these kind of people are fit for political career, to become politicians, that's another story. I think, yes, they can, but they should always keep in mind that a country is not a company. A country is not run as a company is run. This is a very common mistake. Every time I meet business people in Athens and I discuss politics with them, I have the same idea. They think that if they were prime minister, they would sort all problems the same way they sort problems in their companies. Well, a country is not a company. If they keep that in mind, that it is a quite different set of affair, yeah, why not? A businessman can be a good politician as long as he forgets that he is a businessman the moment he enters political life.
Interesting article in today's Financial Times about a decision that's been taken in the government to start sending businessmen abroad as ambassadors. Now, what happens is a long history of doing this, what we call political appointments, to a country like Luxembourg. We'll send a person who gave Bill Clinton $1 million for his campaign. Well, the reward is you get Finland, for example. We do that, but to imagine that all of a sudden a class of businessmen is going to execute the foreign policy of a country better than the professional diplomats, public servants who have this kind of ethos that we're talking about, is a bit of a fantasy, and I don't see it happening. Unless you decide that's it, I give up my fortune and I go, you know, I become a hobbit or something like that.
What I said, you don't know, not only you give up your fortune, you change your mindset to serve as politician.
So there's always an elephant in the room, and I think everyone knows who the elephant in the room is in this particular case. You know, there's you cannot think like a businessman in politics. You've got to think in a different way.
May I please tell a story about mindset?
May we let this other person speak and we'll come back.
Καλησπέρα. Λέγομαι Γιάννακοουλας Χριστός, είμαι ο πατέρας του νεάρου που μίλησε πριν. Καταρχάς, θα ήθελα να απευθυνθώ σε εσάς ως εκπρόσωπο του εκπαιδευτικού οργανισμού Ανατολή και να πω ότι μετά από 12 χρόνια εμπειρίας με τον Τζόρτζ και το σχολείο, δεν ξέρω κατά πόσον βγαίνουν ηγέτες. Σίγουρα πάντως η μεγάλη επιτυχία του σχολείου είναι ότι βγάζει πολίτες του κόσμου και αυτό είναι πιο σημαντικό από το να βγάζει ηγέτες. Αυτό το οποίο θα ήθελα τώρα να ρωτήσω σας, κύριε Τσιμά, είναι το εξής. Επειδή γίνεται συζήτηση ανάμεσα, πάρα πολύ συζήτηση για το public servant, και ήθελα να ρωτήσω από την εμπειρία τη δικιά σας, λόγω δουλειάς με όλους αυτούς τους πολιτικούς όλα αυτά τα χρόνια,
πόσο μεγάλο είναι το ποσοστό των πολιτικών που είναι public servants?
Βαπτίστηκα πολιτικός συντάκτης, δηλαδή με την υποχρέωση να παρακολουθώ επαγγελματικά την πολιτική ζωή, το 1981 το Φεβρουάριο, πριν τις εκλογές του 81. Συνεπώς, όπως καταλαβαίνετε, έχω ζήσει, έχω δει, έχω παρακολουθήσει μια πολύ μακρά περίοδο. Για κάποια χρόνια αυτό ήταν συναρπαστικό, γιατί ήμουν πάρα πολύ νέος, εξωφρενικά νέος δηλαδή, για αυτή τη δουλειά με τα μέτρα της εποχής τουλάχιστον, και έπρεπε ένας σχετικά αδαής και άσχετος νέος να προσπαθεί να καταλάβει το μυαλό, τη σκέψη προσωπικότητων που ήταν, όπως και να το κάνουμε, πάνω από τα κοινά μέτρα. Δηλαδή και ο Κωνσταντίνος Καραμαλής και ο Ανδρέας Παπανδρέου και ο Μητσοτάκης και ο Φλωράκης και ο Κύρκος ήταν προσωπικότητες πάνω από το κοινό μέτρο. Τουλάχιστον στα δικά μου μάτια. Και αυτό έκανε τη δουλειά μου συναρπαστική. Αργότερα ανακάλυψα ότι έχασα το ενδιαφέρον μου για να παρακολουθώ την πολιτική με τον ίδιο τρόπο, δηλαδή τον επαγγελματικό, και πήρα μια απόσταση. Δηλαδή έκανα άλλη δουλειά, έκανα ρεπορτάζ, έρευνες ή σχόλια, αλλά όχι την υποχρέωση του ρεπόρτερ να διαβάζει το μυαλό του πολιτικού. Από ένα σημείο και μετά μου φάνηκε ότι τα μυαλά των πολιτικών δεν είχαν μεγάλο ενδιαφέρον για μένα στη συγκεκριμένη περίοδο. Όμως, στο ερώτημα αν έχω γνωρίσει σε αυτό το διάστημα πολιτικούς οι οποίοι είχαν αυτή την αίσθηση της ευθύνης, της πολιτικής ως ευθύνη, όχι ως καριέρα, μπορώ να σας πω ναι. Αρκετούς. Περισσότερους από όσους πιστεύει κανείς. Αν μπορώ να πω ένα μικρό παράδειγμα που είναι σχετικά πρόσφατο και μου έχει κάνει εντύπωση και δεν θα πω όνομα φυσικά. Με πήρε τηλέφωνο πριν από κάποιο καιρό, επειδή είμαι διευθυντής σύνταξης στο ελληνικό Huffington Post, και με πήρε τηλέφωνο ένας άνθρωπος ο οποίος ήταν επί πάρα πολλά χρόνια υπουργός σε πολλές κυβερνήσεις και σε πολύ σημαντικά υπουργεία και από τα υπουργεία τα οποία διαχειρίζονται μεγάλους προϋπολογισμούς. Είχα καιρό να του μιλήσω, ξαφνιάστηκα που με πήρε τηλέφωνο. Τον ρώτησε τι με ήθελε, αφού ανταλλάξαμε τα τυπικά, τι κάνεις, τι κάνω, βρίσκεσαι κλπ. Και μου λέει, ντρέπομαι αλλά θέλω να σου ζητήσω μια μεγάλη χάρη. Η γυναίκα μου ήταν κάποτε δημοσιογράφος, τα είχε καταλήψει, αλλά επειδή δεν τα βγάζουμε πέρα και σπουδάζουμε ένα παιδί στο πανεπιστήμιο, ήθελα να σε παρακαλέσω, μήπως μπορείς να πεις μια κουβέντα να προσλάβουν τη γυναίκα μου ως δημοσιογράφο, γιατί δεν τα βγάζουμε πέρα. Είναι το τελευταίο πράγμα που περίμενες να ακούσεις από έναν πολιτικό που είναι από τους πιο γνωστούς και που έχει κάνει θητείες σε πολλά και μεγάλα υπουργεία, ξαναλέω με μεγάλους προϋπολογισμούς. Και επειδή είναι, πώς να πω, κάτι αυθεντικό. Ντρεπόταν που μου το ζητούσε, συνεπώς δεν μου έλεγε ψέματα. Λέω ότι τουλάχιστον από την άποψη της εντιμότητας, το τι άφησε πίσω του είναι άλλο θέμα. Είναι προς κρίση. Αλλά τουλάχιστον από την άποψη της εντιμότητας, της ακεραιότητας, λέω να έχω ένα μικρό παράδειγμα που, αν τα παιδιά μου με ρωτήσουν, είναι όλοι πολιτικοί διεφθαρμένα ντομάρια που νοιάζονται μόνο για την τσέπη τους, θα μπορώ να πω όχι, δεν είναι έτσι. Υπάρχει μια μεγάλη κατηγορία πολιτικών που μπήκαν με μια αίσθηση, μπήκαν σε αυτή τη δουλειά, σε αυτό το χώρο, σε αυτό το στίβο, με μια αίσθηση δημόσιας ευθύνης, και κατάφεραν να περάσουν από αυτή τη μιλόπετρα χωρίς να λιώσουν εντελώς. Μπορεί να κάνεις τους συμβιβασμούς σου, μπορείς να συμμαχίσεις με τον διάβολο, μπορείς να κάνεις όλα τα λάθη του κόσμου σε αυτή τη δουλειά, αλλά δεν είναι υποχρεωτικό, και εγώ συμφωνώ με αυτό το μήνυμα, δεν είναι υποχρεωτικό να χάσεις την εντιμότητά σου μέχρι τέτοια.
We hosted an event in 2012 with a professor from the National School of Public Administration. And it was the single most gripping lecture we've hosted at ACP. I can't take credit for it, so I can't say I'm proud of it. But one of the things she said was she loves to come to Thessaloniki because you have these small pockets and small teams of people involved in local public administration who are really trying to make a difference. Mm-hmm. And my guess is there is a core group of people who would resemble Michael Dukakis to some extent. They're there. They're not the politicians. They're not the people who you interview on TV all the time. But you know, for a country to function in any way, you have to have people like this. And I was encouraged when I heard that a couple years ago that, yes, there is a core group of people like that here in Thessaloniki. They don't get a lot of credit. When you think of public servant, the first thing you think of is, where can I kick them? Or something like that. Yes, Kupidia, something like that. But here it is, there are people. You know, we have not, unfortunately, it's growing in the United States. We're developing an allergy in certain circles to the notion of a public servant who worked for the public good. It's associated with groups on the right of the American political spectrum. They have their rationale, and so it's not something you want to criticize blindly. But, you know, we had an approach to working in a public capacity in the period right after the Second World War that's little by little losing its meaning in American public life, and we need something else. When you have a personality like Donald Trump who doesn't want to do anything with anyone, he's just going to do it all himself, then we see what the problem is, basically. But in Greece, I would be encouraged to think that there are professional public administrators who are honest and decent and do their work. And I know some of them, and I'm proud to call them my friends. So, I don't know if that's your experience. You met many more of these people than me, no doubt.
Sure. And, if I can give one example, I mean, it so happened by accident that I met many from the archaeological service, mm-hmm. archaeologists. And that's the most obvious example of public servants that are really public, they feel public servants. They're committed to what they do. They wouldn't change it for all the money in the world. They will never do something that they don't believe it's right. The vast majority of them, it's not the exception.
And they are public servants, right?
They are absolutely public servants. Sometimes they're stubborn, sometimes they're wrong. Sometimes they are stuck with what they think is right, but they are public servants.
You wanted to tell your story?
Υπάρχει ένα ανέκδοτο ιστορία, όπως θέλετε πέστε, το οποίο περιγράφει υπέροχα αυτό που εξηγείτε τόση ώρα για το attitude που αποτελεί το public service. Ήταν δύο εργάτες και οι δύο σπάζαν πέτρες και ρώτησαν τον έναν, τι κάνεις? Και αυτός είπε, άσε μωρέ, πρωί βράδυ σπάζω πέτρες. Αυτό. Όταν ρώτησαν τον άλλον, εκείνος τους απάντησε περήφανα, χτίζουμε μια εκκλησία. Η στάση που έχουμε απέναντι στα πράγματα ορίζει και την κατεύθυνση και αυτή μας εμπλέει για ανάπτυξη, για να πάμε μπροστά και να πάμε μαζί. Και αυτό είναι πιο σημαντικό από όλα. Να είστε καλά.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to take this moment. I have a student who wants to ask a question, but I'd like to acknowledge a couple people whom I haven't acknowledged yet. Theo Malleus, who works in the Office of Student Services, taking the photos. Thank you, Theo. We have a couple instructors, Ruth Sutton, whom I've acknowledged, and I'll apologize to you publicly in front of 800 people here for putting this video on without telling you. And Lambrini Nassis, who does public affairs work for the Dukakis Center. He was on radio earlier today. We have a couple other colleagues from ACT and Anatolia. I want to thank you personally for coming down here. Now, yes, can we grab a microphone for... I'm thinking it's Anita.
I'm close.
Καλησπέρα σας. Εμένα η ερώτησή μου απευθύνεται λίγο πιο πολύ προς τον κύριο Τσίμα. Είμαστε πολύ ευχαριστημένοι που είστε εδώ πέρα. Είναι ευκαιρία για μας. Εγώ θα ήθελα να σας ρωτήσω κάτι λίγο πιο γενικό, αλλά και πιο σχετικό με το συγκεκριμένο θέμα που έχουμε σήμερα. Γιατί ενώ η τηλεόραση είναι ένα τόσο δυνατό μέσο, δεν προβάλλει πρότυπα στους νέους όπως ο κύριος Δουκάκης, ώστε να μην βλέπουν μόνο την αρνητική πλευρά της πολιτικής, η οποία προβάλλεται καθημερινά,
και πλέον έχουμε γίνει απαθείς, σαν αντισώματα. Γιατί λοιπόν δεν προβάλλονται και λίγο τέτοια πρότυπα, ώστε να ξυπνήσουν και λίγο οι νέοι και να δουν ότι υπάρχει και η άλλη πράξη, τάξη των πραγμάτων. Συγγνώμη, να προσθέσω και κάτι άλλο μικρό. Δηλαδή, επειδή έτυχε και ήμουν φοιτήτρια και σε δημόσιο ελληνικό πανεπιστήμιο, αλλά και εδώ πέρα, εγώ έμαθα για τον κύριο Δουκάκη επειδή ήμουν φοιτήτρια στο Ανατόλια, στο ACT. Άλλοι συμφοιτητές μου από πανεπιστήμιο ελληνικό δεν έχουν ιδέα. Οι περισσότεροι ποιο είναι και τι αντιπροσωπεύει σαν άνθρωπο.
Ένα, έχετε δίκιο. Είναι φανερό ότι αν υπάρχει κάτι που, μάλλον ότι υπάρχει μια ανάγκη να αναδείξεις θετικές ιστορίες και θετικά πρόσωπα και θετικές τάσεις. Αν παρακολουθείτε σινεμά ή θέατρο, ξέρετε όμως ότι είναι πολύ δύσκολο να το κάνεις αυτό. Είναι πολύ δυσκολότερο να το κάνεις αυτό από το να πλέξεις μια ιστορία γύρω από έναν αρνητικό χαρακτήρα, γύρω από έναν κακό. Οι ταινίες στο σινεμά, εκείνες που είναι πιο δημοφιλείς, εκείνες που είναι πιο πετυχημένες, εκείνες που κάνουν τους θεατές να γεμίζουν το σινεμά, είναι οι ταινίες που ψάχνουν, που γυρίζουν γύρω από ένα αρνητικό πρότυπο, δηλαδή σε μια μάχη καλού και κακού. Το κακό είναι πάντα πιο συναρπαστικό και στο σινεμά και στην τηλεόραση, σε κάθε μορφή αφήγησης. Είναι πολύ πιο δύσκολο να φτιάξεις μια ενδιαφέρουσα και συναρπαστική αφήγηση γύρω από ένα θετικό πρότυπο. Αυτή είναι μια απάντηση. Είναι μια δικαιολογία, αν θέλετε. Μια δεύτερη δικαιολογία είναι, πρέπει να ορίσουμε τι είναι δημοσιογραφία. Υπάρχουν πολλοί ορισμοί. Αλλά κάποιος που υπήρξε για πάρα πολλά χρόνια αρχισυντάκτης των Times του Λονδίνου, όταν τον είχαν ρωτήσει σε μια αντίστοιχη, σε ένα κολέγιο που είχε πάει, τι είναι η δουλειά που κάνετε, τι είναι δημοσιογραφία, δώστε με ένα ορισμό της δημοσιογραφίας. Είχε πει, δημοσιογραφία είναι να ψάχνεις και να λες κάτι που κάποιος μπάσταρδος με εξουσία προσπαθεί να κρύψει.
Okay.
Η δουλειά, αυτό που περιγράφει είναι ένα μέρος της δουλειάς μας. Θέλω να πω, αυτό δεν σημαίνει τίποτα. Δεν πρέπει να βρίσκεις τρόπους να αφηγηθείς θετικές ιστορίες ή να αναδείξεις θετικές ιστορίες που μπορεί να επηρεάσουν θετικά το δουλειά.
I was inclined to answer the question, but let's go somewhere else. It may come back to me. That joke just threw me off my track. Okay. Anyone else in the room like to pose a question to our guest speaker or relate something about their experience in 1988 or thereafter, a memory of Michael Dukakis?
Ο οποίος έγινε καθηγητής πανεπιστημίου στην Αγγλία, στο Οξφόρντ είναι, και ήταν ένας από τους μεγαλύτερους γνώστες του δικαίου, του συγκριτικού δικαίου, που είναι ένας κλάδος πολύ δύσκολος, γιατί πρέπει να ξέρεις τα δίκαια όλων των χωρών. Αυτός είναι ακόμη διδάσκει, είναι σύμβουλος της Βασιλής Ελισάβετ, και έχει πάρει ανώτατα βραβεία από τους κυβερνήτες όλων των ευρωπαϊκών κρατών από υπηρεσίες που προσέφερε στους κυβερνήτες όταν δούλεψε σε όλη την Ευρώπη νεότερος όταν ήταν. Έγραψε ένα βιβλίο την ιστορία του πατέρα του και μετά έγραψε ένα βιβλίο την ιστορία της ζωής του και έγραψε στο Μέγαρο Μουσικής και το παρουσίασε στο δεύτερο του βιβλίο. Ήταν ένα κατάμεστο ακροατήριο. Έκανε πάρα πολύ μεγάλη αυτή η εντύπωση, όλη αυτή η τέτοια αυτή, αλλά επειδή το ξέραμε όλοι, ο γιος του τέτοιου, του
Μαρτίζη
Σόφου. Κόλλησα.
Το Βασίλειο Μαρτίζη.
Το Βασίλειο. Ευχαριστώ πολύ. Ο Μαρτίζη Βασίλειο. Στο τέλος ο Κόλλης, μερικά χρόνια. Ο Νάση, έλα εδώ όπως ο πατέρας να κυβερνήσεις. και σηκώνοντας τάξη κάνει μια κίνηση στο καθένα, εγώ λέει, δεν είμαι λέει κυβερνήτης, εγώ είμαι λέει σύμβουλος. Δεν μπορώ να κυβερνήσω, δεν είναι για μένα, δεν είναι για μένα αυτό. Είμαι σύμβουλος, φωνάζω ο κόμμας από κάτω. Τότε λέει, δώσε μας μια συμβουλή, τι να κάνω.
Μιλόμαστε.
Θα σας δώσουμε τρεις συμβουλές. Πρώτον, να βρείτε ανθρώπους στην πολιτική που δεν έχουν ξανά ασχοληθεί με την πολιτική. Νέους ανθρώπους. Δεύτερον, θα είναι αυτοί οι άνθρωποι πετυχημένοι στο επάγγελμά τους. Δεν είναι επάγγελτοι, θα είναι πετυχημένοι σε αυτό που κάνουν. Και αυτούς θα αναδείξετε στην πολιτική. Αυτά ήταν τα λίγα που είπε και τα θυμάμαι εγώ. Ευχαριστώ.
Success. So we have a lot of success stories in the current administration in the United States. Mm-hmm. Are they doing any better than the previous administration?
Another fail.
No.
Because the president is failed, totally failed as a politician. His father, I mean.
Uh-huh. Well, he was an excellent minister of economics in the mid-50s. He is the one who made the drachma stable. Fought inflation in 1953, but...
Kartaris.
Yes, but he prepared, but, you know, Kartaris the credit goes to the one who did it. But anyway, I tend to think that politics is a profession. It's not a hobby.
Okay.
That someone who has been trained to do something else can jump in and do better than someone who has a vocation, has been trained to do that. Yeah. I would have much more faith into a decent professional politician than to somebody who has been successful in another profession and
trying to transfer
it into politics.
I'll interject here, and the gentleman had a question. This is in respect to something you said at the end of your question, Anita. One, and it's a response to an earlier question. One of the events I'm really proud of is an event we call Politics at the Bistro. And I invited two Democratic delegates at the time when Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton were competing for the Democratic nomination. And we opened it to students from Aristotle University and University of Macedonia. And they came in large numbers, you remember that. And we had an incredible conversation about politics. I'm certain that my friends in the United States who were delegates learned something about their own politics. And we do that a lot. We try. Because we represent a private foundation doesn't mean that somehow we're divorced from the rest of your community. It's just the opposite. The unfortunate thing that I find in Greece, and you'll forgive me for saying this, is that the public universities have tended in the past to be a little closed. They form little bubble communities, and it's very difficult for an outsider to integrate and be part of it. That's changing a little bit now, and I think the crisis has perhaps accelerated a little bit. But our modus vivendi is to be open to whomever wants to come and sit down and talk a little bit about politics and politics, thinking that at some point in time, a person who's trained in politics is going to be called upon to make important decisions. Yeah. Gentlemen, here we missed your turn here. Would you like to ask your question?
Yeah, thank you. Καλησπέρα σας. Καταρχήν χαίρομαι που είστε καλύτερος από τη τηλεόραση από κοντά και είναι πολύ... Αναφέρατε πριν ότι όταν βρίσκεστε με επιχειρηματίες, αναλύουν πολύ διαφορετικά το πώς θα είναι τα προβλήματα. Θα ήθελα κάτι πολύ συγκεκριμένο, αν γίνεται, κάτι πιο συγκεκριμένο σχετικά με αυτό, να το αναπτύξετε. Ευχαριστώ.
Αυτό που είπα είναι ότι υπάρχει μια τάση που μπορεί στο μυαλό των περισσότερων από εμάς να φαίνεται σχεδόν φυσική.
ένας άνθρωπος που έχει φτιάξει μια πετυχημένη εταιρεία, που, έχει πάρει, που είχε μια ιδέα, έκτισε μια εταιρεία, την δίευθυνε, δίευθυνε μερικές δεκάδες χιλιάδες εργαζόμενους, άνοιξε αγορές, πλούτησε, αυτός ο άνθρωπος δεν είναι ένας ιδανικός πρωθυπουργός?
Όχι.
Αυτό λέω και εγώ, όχι. Γιατί δανείζομαι, ναι, δανείζομαι τον τίτλο ενός πολύ, μιας πολύ ενδιαφέρουσας διάλεξης που είχε ακριβώς αυτόν τον τίτλο. A country is not a company. Είναι διάλεξη ενός πολύ διάσημου οικονομολόγου που έχει πάρει βραβείο Νόμπελ, ο οποίος εξηγούσε ποια είναι η διαφορά των public economics, δηλαδή των δημόσιων οικονομικών, από τα οικονομικά μιας επιχείρησης και γιατί η συνταγή που κάνει μια επιχείρηση επιτυχημένη θα ήταν καταστροφική αν εφαρμοζόταν σε μια κοινωνία, σε μια χώρα. Αυτό ήθελα να πω. Αυτό τείνουν πολλοί να το πιστέψουν και οι ίδιοι άνθρωποι. Δηλαδή, ένας πολύ πετυχημένος επιχειρηματίας που έχει πραγματικά την αυτοπεποίθηση κάποιου που πέτυχε από το τίποτα και μόνος του, θεωρεί ότι αυτά που ο ίδιος ξέρει και αυτά που ο ίδιος θεωρεί σωστά, αν τα έλεγε στον Πρωθυπουργό και ο Πρωθυπουργός τα έκανε, τα προβλήματα της χώρας θα λύνονταν. Η εμπειρία λέει ότι οι πρωθυπουργοί που άκουγαν συμβουλές επιχειρηματιών συνήθως αποτύχαναν. Και έχουμε βέβαια το πολύ κοντινό παράδειγμα της Ιταλίας, όπου ένας επιτυχημένος με τον τρόπο του επιχειρηματίας, ο Μπερλουσκόνη, έγινε πρωθυπουργός της χώρας, αλλά δεν νομίζω ότι άφησε legacy που θα, η ιστορία θα το τιμά. Αυτό, αυτή ήταν η άποψη.
Now, publication less than The Economist thought that it was a catastrophic idea for Berlusconi to become.
Yeah.
And I remember that article really, really vividly. We'd like to thank our speaker for coming here this evening. Say also for me, it was really a great pleasure to have you here, and I hope maybe the first of other times as well. We had an idea that came from the floor that you all think like Michael Dukakis, do something this week that would constitute a public service. Tell, we're doing a marketing pitch here, but I'm not certain that you'll think of it this way. Tell other people what happened here today. If there's something positive that came about as a result of your listening to Pavlos talk a little bit, we are welcome. We're happy to have you share ideas. Why don't you do something like this? Why don't you invite such and such a speaker? Why not host an event on this topic? Right? It's meaning for us when we get feedback from our public to think about, okay, what's our next event? I have five or six in mind tomorrow, but are they events that would be meaningful for the people who come this evening? So there you are, and you can think of it, gee whiz, I've just done a public service. I've gave the listener a nice idea, and maybe other people will come and they'll benefit as a result. Now, because I speak fast, and I would like to acknowledge the work of our translators, Σας ευχαριστώ, Cleo και Michael Weber. Thanks to the interns, to my colleagues here, to the staff at the library for hosting us. This is the Bissell Library, the biggest private library in Southeast Europe, and we're really proud of it. When you come here during the day when we have 350, 400 students mingling around, it's something for the eye to behold. We've got a couple gifts for you. Thanks for your coming here.
Thanks.
And
it was really a pleasure.
I'm going to turn off the mic because I don't think we need to translate. This is a certificate of appreciation. It used to be that we offered Dukakis lecturers membership in the History and International Relations Society, ACT. We gave certificates to Nicholas Burns, to Nikiforos Diamandouros, and why wouldn't we give you something similar here? Thank you for coming to ACP and the Dukakis Center down in Anatolia in Thessaloniki, the school that you almost attended. You come back. Now, we also have something.
Thank you.
Well, that's great.
Thank you.
paperweight that Anatolia College commissioned in 1998 to commemorate the decision to launch the Dukakis Chair, which has become the Dukakis Center. So you put it somewhere on your desk, you probably have several such memoranda.
That is a good one.
Okay? 1998, no less. And here we have a history of Anatolia College by a former president, Carl Compton. So if you ever have time to read a little bit, perhaps on your flight back to Athens.
So I've been reading your book.
How about that?
Yeah.
When you haven't finished it yet. In the sense it's very short.
No, it's very short. It's, it's a pleasure to read.
Well, thank you very much for saying that. Okay, so here we are, ladies and gentlemen. If you'd like to come and rub elbows.